I'm Joseph from ISEP, and this will be an introduction to model checking. So we'll not talk about our use case, our method. We're going to mainly try to make sure that the concept of model checking, which is used by many partners here, is clear for those partners who are not so familiarized with the concept of formal methods or model checking. So first of all, before I start, I want to make very clear that model checking consists on checking some kind of requirements over some kind of model, and this is formal methods. So by formal methods, I mean that both the requirements and the model are specified using some kind of mathematical data structure, which is very well known and understood, where we can apply transformations, analysis, and so forth. So in this training section in particular, what you're going to see first is how to what are exactly these models. So typically these are some kind of transition systems that also are built using some other notion of composition. Then you'll take a better look of what requirements are in this context. So these are typically logical expressions using some kind of logics, and there are many kind of logics we can use. And I'm going to illustrate these concepts of model checking using two model checkers I'm familiarized with, but there are many others. So I'm going to show quickly how MCL2 works and how OPAL can be used as well. So the main idea is that you know what it means to grab an existing system and represent the model, and then represent the requirements using some logic. So many of you are already familiarized with you, so this is not being anything new. But if you've seen the name model checking, somehow this might help you understanding exactly what it means to perform model checking to a system. So this is very important. The first thing I want to say that all formal models are wrong. And by wrong here, I mean that when you want to model something, the first thing you do is take out all the details that you think are not relevant until you're able to get a more concise model that abstracts many of the things that are present. So you don't want to include your programs and all the details that are present in your actual system, software or mix of hardware and software, but you want to have only the details that are important for your system. So all are wrong, but some of them are useful. So that's the main goal of model checking, or the first process of building up a model, is being able to make sure that when you abstract, you are able to abstract the exact things that allow you to end up with a very small, compact model where you can control the state explosion and how much you can explore your system, but make sure that the analysis that you make over this model somehow reflect your actual system. So in model checking, there's this huge phase in the beginning where you make sure that the model you have is actually useful, and that's the starting point. So I'm not going to use any complex example in this presentation. I'm going to use a very popular example in our community, which is modeling a coffee machine. So a coffee machine, in this case, you have a coffee that can be brewed, and you have some interface where you can insert coins, pre-press the buttons, and there's internally some state machine behind it. So I guess it's very popular in the more fundamental community because that's the kind of thing we constantly need in order to produce results and papers. So in this context, we usually write this to capture the thing, the model checking process. So we describe some kind of model, this funny M. We describe some kind of state, and we ask ourselves or ask the tools, does this model in this state particularly satisfies or models entails the requirements specified by this formula? So this is the mathematical notation, and basically means that we grab some requirement, a more complex system, typically a state machine, and then we try to check using some kind of brute force or something smarter if we can say yes or no to this property. So that's the key of model checking. So in this example, one possible abstraction or simplification of the internals could be this. So we can build a three-state machine where we can start by this S1 and at some point insert some coin. At that point, we can either give up or make a selection. And inside each state, so finally in S3, we can start brewing the coffee. And at some point, we can get some change back if it exists. So we can also have this notion of prepositions, these propositions, which mean coin, selection, brew. They are basically logical, Boolean variables or Boolean expressions. So something we can check or not check in each of the states. So right now they are some kind of variables, but can be something more complex than that. So in here we can see that typically this model inside, they consist of a set of states, a set of actions that connect the states, and a set of propositions of something we can check in each of the states. And getting the right model is very often something non-trivial that requires a lot of iterations, refinements, because this can get very big very quickly, and it's not easy to be able to filter out the essentials with respect to the properties that we want to prove. So that'll be our running example for the rest of this presentation. But for example, in the context of the use case with Bombardier, we're actually trying to get a similar model to this, but more complex one, to understand if a system running multiple redundant processes that need to be synchronized somehow, if you can guarantee that they always keep in sync with when can this go wrong, using also some time restrictions. So this model can get very complex very easily. So this is the model. I'm trying to change slides. Yeah. And now with respect to the requirements are these properties right here. So we can write something like, does this model M on top in state S2, does this formula called coin holds, which means does the preposition coin holds when in state S2? So here the answer will be yes, because this coin has this check mark next to it. Another possible model checking property could be, does this model in state S1, if any possible way of making this action called make selection, will the proposition selection hold? So these are already including actions in the middle of our formula. So these formulas can actually contain more complex things, and the expressivity of this formula capture what kind of requirements we can specify when you look at properties we want to reason about. So right now I talked a lot about actions and states, and this is a trend you can see quite often when looking at approaches to model check. So I'm going to now take a better look at these two approaches. So there's an approach that quite often looks at the action. So what possible sequence of actions are possible or not possible, desired or forbidden in our system. And very often these systems use the kind of process algebra to generate these transition systems. And indeed, in this case, we don't really care about the propositions themselves. What you care is about the actions, the traces, the paths we take. So we want to make sure certain kinds of sequence are possible or not possible. And this is very useful, especially when you're modeling interacting systems and you want to reason about the interaction between them. So another approach is this focus on states, where you see these labels no longer have any information, and what you care is about reasoning about the state. So you want to care which states are reachable, which may never be reached, and something in the middle. So quite often use some kind of language or diagram or automa to be able to generate what exactly mean by our model or our transition systems. And here quite often use these propositions somehow enriched with some kind of modalities. So special keywords or expressions that describe if it's for all possible paths, if somewhere in the future, in the next step, or these kind of constructions. So before I go into this, I just want to give to bring two small notes. So the first note is that the logic used and the notion used for your model, they are tightly related. They are very interconnected. So for example, when you say these are the kind of logics you can express, this will induce automatically some notion of equivalence here. So the class of models that obey the same logical propositions. And this often corresponds to the notion of bisimulation, for example. And you can have other notions of equivalence, like they can perform the same paths, which are similar but different things. So it becomes very important when you model your system and modeling your properties, you understand very clearly what does it mean to have two equivalent systems also with respect to the properties. So this is often studied, multiple notions of equivalence, if you want to simplify this and how this impacts the properties you have here. So that's more on the more formal analysis of the system. And similarly, you can also analyze the notion of inclusion. So inclusion is very useful if you want to say, I have this system, a set of properties, can I replace this system with something smaller or something more refined? So this is typically something that simulates or has the same traces. So these are the things you can investigate once you have the model and also a set of properties you care about. And the final goal is to be able to drive a model that captures exactly what you need to know in order to show the requirements. So once you have a notion of the kind of requirements you need, then the goal of modeling becomes filtering out and making sure this becomes very, very to the point without introducing unnecessary details. And this is by far not an easy task. So my second note is on the choice of the model and the logic. So there are many, many logics, and I'm not going to go through these logics, but quite often this is the starting point. When you look at the requirements, you understand, do I need to reason about the actual time that things take between different actions? Or do I need to have actually more refined notion of time when you have this notion of differential dynamic logic? So if you need to specify the evolution of the state using differential equations, which is very common when you interact with physical systems like accelerations of a vehicle or something else. You also sometimes need to know and reason about beliefs. If you have multiple parties, multiple agents, you want to know who knows exactly what and who trusts who, you start talking about the notion of beliefs with the so-called epistemic logics. And similarly, you have deontic logics to reason about mandatory or actions you may be able to do at each state. Logics that talk about values, so you don't really say just a value which says yes or no, but I can actually assign a weight both to your system and to the logics you want to express. Probabilistics is a subcase of this fuzzy logics where I can talk about the probabilities of something happening, and there are many tools for this. So these are the kind of tools I've been encountered. So MCR2 and Yupal will see now a small tool demo. Spin is very common for probabilistic systems. This new SMV or extensions is something that it's also being built among our partners. So Stefano from Bruno Kessler Foundation, I think they are the ones actually involved in the creation of this. Microsoft tries to push this TLA Plus, which is already quite old but still being used in practice. Manytool over Petrinets. So there are lots of tools that help you building models and verifying logical properties with different variations of logics even within inside of each of these model checkers. So if you care about any of these, you can contact either us or other members that will actually be able to help you guiding on how to build models and logics for your own systems. So let's go now with a small tool demo. So I have two very short tool demos. The first one will be to show this MCRL2, which is developed in Eindhoven in the Netherlands. And this is something completely free. So there are no commercial connections, and they actually being used quite actively in several industries. So this is well known because it works quite well with large systems, and they focus on actions. So if you look at our system, typically, they don't look at these propositions we have here. What the system that is built is mainly focused on verifying what kind of actions can be executed, what possible traces. So this will be our way of modeling in our system. So you write in something that's called some process algebra, and you say that in the beginning, we can perform a coin action followed by a choice. So this plus captures the choice between either selecting and starting to brew, or aborting and returning to the start state. And once we are brewing, which is this S3 state, we can perform brewing and return to this brew state, or we can choose to give some change and come back to start state. So this is the way we actually write the system. And you can go further than this. We can actually build completion of systems that have actions that are for synchronized with other actions. So I'm going to open now M3L2. So let's see if I find the mouse here. So the simple example here basically means that you have this IDE. You write here what kind of actions you have, what are your processes, and you say, I'm starting with process start. And the kind of things you can do often is you can ask to show the state space. So in this case, it's a very small state space. This is exactly the system we had behind. We have only three states, but the number of states grows very quickly when you start introducing more details to your system. So I'm going to close this. Other things we can do is also ask to simulate. So once you simulate, you're basically selecting actions. I just did the first action called coin, and now I have the two options to perform. So I keep performing actions as I click, and we have the trace, the path we took. So this is useful once you have a very big system and once you start having some intuition of what's happening. So simulation, seeing the state space, and finally we'll be able to verify things, but this I'll show in the next slide. So once you have your system modeled properly, the next thing you want to do is to verify. And that's where the logic comes at hand. So we specify different logical properties. I'm going to show an example of this first one. And this language is very, very precise and sometimes not very clear how to go from the natural language specification into something that actually captures the logical property. So in this example, you have this property saying, always, no matter what, I want to make sure that eventually I can get my coffee. So brewing is possible. So this is how I specify here. I have these square brackets and saying, no matter which actions I do, so this true captures any action. The star means any sequence of action. So after any possible set of any set of actions, so after doing a coin, a select, and the board, I did five different actions, then it must exist this pattern. So there must exist a sequence of zero or more actions where I can perform brewing. So no matter how far I reach, I can press some buttons into some coins and make sure I can get my coins. I can get my coffee. So there are other variations, some more complex and less complex. Brewing is always possible. This feels very similar, but this is the same as the top one, but basically saying that no matter how many steps I do, then it exists the possibility of brewing. So by dropping this true star. So this will be false, which basically means I cannot always get a coffee. If I don't put a coin, I'll not have a coffee. So, and there are a lot of subtleties that you can do. And if you change this a bit, you'll change the interpretation. And it's something that is also part of the process of verification, is get these logical properties right. So in our running example, I lost the mouse. Here it is. I have here a small property saying I can brew. So it means it's possible to execute a sequence of steps where brewing is possible. So if I save and ask to model check will tell me yes or no. And in this case, I can also ask to get to show a witness, an example of how come I can actually brew a coffee. In this case, the example is in terms of a subset of that graph saying, here's the possible path to be able to perform the brewing action. So model checking in a nutshell means specifying your model, specifying your property, and hopefully so get a yes or no. And in more advanced cases, you can actually get either a witness or a counterexample where your property failed, but it's not always possible. And there are certain properties where you can try to guide or give scenarios that try to explain why this holds or not holds, but not always you can present this. So this is M3L2, at least a very short view of it. And now I'm going to jump into the other tool, Upal, which also exists for many years. So this was developed by the Uppsala and the Aalborg universities in Sweden. So this is not free anymore in the sense that commercial projects actually need special licenses, but for academic purposes, we can use very easily. So in this system, what Upal does is ignores all these actions. So we can actually introduce some notion of action, but the action is only used for synchronizing between parallel systems, and it's not used for this model checking part. So in this case, it focuses mainly on the states and on this proposition that you can have here. So this is how we define. So actually draw it using some graphical tool. And you'll say that in state S1, we can go to S2 and you update the variable called coin and make it true. Initially, we set all of them to false. And as we traverse the system, we keep changing these variables. And these variables are booleans, but can also make them integers or something more complex. But typically, you want to make sure this is bounded to make sure that the state space is not growing too much. So in this case, also they also have the possibility of modeling some time properties, which cannot do before. So to give you a very small flavor, we assume we have this special variable t. So t looks like an integer or number, but it's actually a stopwatch. So it basically measures the time it passes. When going here, we say that this stopwatch is set to zero, and then stopwatch keeps evolving. We have also this invariant saying that we cannot remain here if the stopwatch increases more than 8. And we have an action that has some guard saying we can only perform this action that corresponds to the brewing action if time is actually greater than 5. So you can specify some extra temporal properties, and these are very useful in some systems, and it's the kind of thing you're also exploiting in our use case. So let me jump into Upal. So Upal is here. And let me run our example. So this is the example we saw there. Upal does not allow you to explore anymore the state space more precisely because there's a notion of evolution of time that's not explicit here because it's already very graphical. What we can do is to ask to simulate, for example. And we simulate, we can see that coffee has certain variables here and there are some time constraints. And here we can choose the action we can do. So this coffee selected, which means the coffee machine can do this action, which is in red. I'll just double click here. And then we see that now we are in state S2. So we're basically trying to go through the system. The constraints keep changing. Now we have two options. As I click on them, the red arrow changes and saying which option I can actually choose. And here we have the trace, so the path we took to get there. So this one way of going through the system, building some state machine as we go. And this is especially useful if you have communication between multiple automata. So instead of one, you can have 2, 3, 4. And again, having some certain arrows being forced synchronized with other arrows that are in parallel. So this is the composition aspect, which I just don't have time to go into detail here. And we have this verification part. So the verification part is something I want to go after going to the next slide. So before we had the system with one logic, now we have a different logic to reason about this system. So the same system, but now we can ask something very, very similar to what before, which means, can I always get eventually a coffee? So here, this property here actually means no matter what kind of choice I make, is it eventually possible to get a coffee? This seems very similar, but it's not the same as the previous expression, because not for all choices I can always get a coffee, in the sense that if I choose to insert a coin and then give up, and a coin and give up, so basically I have a behavior where I choose always something, but not something that leads me to get a coffee. So it's not possible to, for all possible choices, to have eventually in the future the brewing of the coffee. So to have this brew, which only holds in S3. So it's possible to specify more properties. And on the next slide, I'm also going to explain better what this syntax means. But sometimes, like this property where it says, No matter which choices, for all possible choices I can make in my system, at every single step in the future, for every possible state I can go to, then previous S1 implies S2. So this previous S1 is a new variable. So sometimes you actually need to go back to your system and extend it with some variables just for the model checking purposes. So this means if the previous state is S1, so you have a variable that says the previous state is S1, then S2 must hold. Then S2 is already a special variable to say we are in S2. So this way we can also model something like if I introduce a coin, then I'll be in this state. And you can also reason about the values of these stopwatches. Is it always possible that if I'm brewing, if brewing is true, can I guarantee that time is different from 10? So I never spend more than 10 time units waiting for my coffee. So you can also exploit these time properties, and that's how time is expressed in the properties and in the system. Finally, there's also this kind of implication, but this is different from this implies here. So this is the temporal implication. So this basically is saying, if I introduce a coin, am I guaranteed that I'll have a coffee, or there will be coffee somehow in the future? And this does not hold, because in our model, we say it's possible for the person to change his mind in the port system. So this gives you a view of how to write these properties. It's an extremely simple system. So this can be considered actually to be not a good model, because it allows some kind of infinite behavior, so we can do actions without time being passed. So there are actual restrictions that you need to know when modeling time systems, but this will not be the goal of this presentation. So just to give you now back to our UPAL, once I have the mouse sometimes disappears. Here it is. So we can go to this tab for the verification. And you can see you can write this kind of properties we have here. The first coffee asks, does it exist a set of choices such that somewhere in the future I'll be able to brew the coffee? So can I actually have a coffee if I want to? And if I check it, it becomes green saying, yes, everything is okay. And we can do the same kind of thing for the other properties. In this case, the red means no, it's not guaranteed that for all possible choices you make, you will get a coffee in the future, because you might do choices that do not get you a coffee. And you can also ask to get a trace. To get a trace, we'll say, yeah, we'll create a simulation for you. And once you go to the simulation, it will show you a path of choices saying, that's how I was able to traverse your system to actually to get the system. So very similar to the witness we saw before. So this is almost my final slide. I hope I'm not taking too long. So this is just to say that you can actually group these kind of properties in UPAL as safety properties. And by safety properties are the ones that says, I can guarantee that some property phi will actually hold always in the future, either for any possible choice I may make, or if I'm smart, I can make sure phi always holds. So these are called the safety properties. And these properties are typically invariants, saying something bad will not happen. That's why it's called safety. We also have quite often these reachability properties, which are very useful in some systems, and very often the main thing that model checkers try to be good at, which is to show that, can I actually get coffee at some point? If I'm smart enough, and am I guaranteed that at some point I'll be able to get coffee? And this is a typical reachability question. Other liveness questions like this, or a refinement on that one, means if no matter what choice I make, can I guarantee that something will happen? So this is guaranteeing that coffee is possible to be achieved. And a refinement which is useful, which means, can I guarantee that if I put a coin or if something happens, my guarantee to get the coffee? So these are the temporal property that is actually a shortcut for something a bit more complex. And UPAL also restricts the kind of combinations we can make of this, just to make sure it's actually decidable and you can get it in feasible time. So this was my short overview over model checking. So what are requirements? What is the model? There are many, many tools. Getting the model right with respect to requirements you want is difficult. I illustrated with two different model checkers that have different mentalities. I did not focus so much in composition, but this is something very important, how to build big systems by composing different processes here or different automata here. And we can have lots of flavors for these logics. So I hope I helped at least some of you understanding what model checking means. If you have any question, please let me know.